worth the waiting for. Every little 84, all we ever get is cruel. Every day we say our prayer, will it change the bill of fare? Still we get the same old cruel. There's not a crust, not a crumb. Can we find, can we beg, can we borrow or catch? But there's nothing to stop but some getting a thrill when we all close our eyes and imagine. Good morning, hot sausage and mustard.
please, sir. I want some more.
What?
Please, sir. I want some more.
More! Catch him! Snatch him! Hold him!
Before has a boy wanted more.
Oliver. Or ask for more, but he knows what's in store.
There's a dark, deep, winding stairway without any banister, which will throw him down and feed him on cockroaches. So then a canister.
Oliver.
What will he do when he's turned black and blue? He will curse the day somebody named him Oliver. A boy wanted more.
Oliver. Oh, ask for more when he knows what's in store.
There's a soaring chimney long overdue for a sweeping out, which will push him up, and one day next year with rats will come creeping out.
Oliver.
What will he do in this terrible stew? He will rue the day somebody named him
unprecedented, quite utterly.
He's disgraced this place.
Encouraging others to follow in gluttony.
Oliver.
Lock him in jail and then put him on sale.
For the highest bid, let him be rid of
Oliver.
Lock him up, collect his belongings, and bring him back to me exactly when you're done. And to bed, all of you!
Mark my words, Mrs. Corney. That boy was born to be hung. I've never been so shocked in all my days.
Oh, hush, Mr. Bay. You've taken quite a turn, and I think you'd fancy a drop of something special.
What is it?
Why, it's one of the lights to keep little of in the house, to put in the blessed infant's medicine when they ain't doing too well. And I'm not deceiving you, Mr. Bay. It's gin.
Well, you are a very humane woman, Mrs. Corney. It's nice to be appreciated. Them paupers in this parish, they don't appreciate me. Anti-parochial they are. Anti-parochial. You put this in infant's medicine? We've given away, Mrs. Corney, a matter of 20 loaves and a cheese and a half this very afternoon. And still them paupers is not contented.
Well, of course they ain't. What would they be, sweet Mr. Bumble?
Very sweet indeed, ma'am.
Bless you.
Do you still keep a cat, ma'am?
You are, yes. sea kittens too. I'm quite fond of the creatures, you can't imagine, Mr. Bumble. They're so happy, so cheerful, and so frolicsome. They make quite good companions for me.
Very nice animals indeed, ma'am. So very domestic.
And fond of their home too. That's a pleasure, I'm sure.
I mean to say this, Miss Corny, ma'am, that any cat or kitten that lives in your home and is not fond of it is an idiot and doesn't deserve to live in it.
Oh, Mr. Bumble!
It's no use disguising facts, ma'am. An idiot! And I would drown it myself with pleasure.
Well, then, you're a very cruel man and a very hard-hearted man besides.
Hard-hearted, Mrs. Corning? Hard? Are you hard-hearted, Mrs. Corning?
Why? What a curious question coming from a single man. Why ever could you want to know from Mr. Bumble? Oh, Mr. Bumble! I shall scream! You're a naughty bad man. If you think I can't be proper, prim and haughty, I can. And you'll pardon if I mention, you must say your true intentions.
Is there not another room here?
No.
If there were a bride and groom here, would there be?
Well, there might.
We shall see.
I shall scream. I shall scream. At the thought of what you're thinking, I shall scream.
We will wonder where that scream went.
When we come to an agreement, as my lovely dove is chubby, could she love a chubby hubby?
I shall scream, Mr. Bumble, I shall scream, Bumble Bumble, I shall scream, scream, scream!
Off to see what I can get for the young scoundrel.
Get good
advice
from Mr. Bumble.
Oliver, stand over here, boy.
One boy, boy, for sale. Seven guineas, that are thereabouts. Small boy, rather pale, from lack of sleep, feeding cruel dinners, stop him getting stout. If I should say he wasn't very greedy, I could not, I'd be telling you a tale. One boy, boy for sale, come take a peep. Have you ever seen as nice a boy for sale?
Liberal terms, Mr. Sowerberry. Liberal terms, £3.
Well, as a matter of fact, I was needing a boy.
Good. Then it's settled. One parochial apprentice, £3, please.
If you don't mind, cash upon liking. Mr. Bumble. Cash upon liking. Mrs. Sowerberry!
What is it?
Oliver, stand over there. Keep your head up, boy.
Sir!
Well, what do you want? What is it? Oh, Mr. Bumble.
My dear, I have told Mr. Bumble that we might consider taking in this boy to help in the shop.
Dear me, he's very small.
Very small indeed, ma'am. There's no denying it. But he'll grow, Mr. Salvary. He'll grow. Mr. Salvary. Mr. Salvary. I apologize.
I'm over here.
I didn't notice.
I dare say he'll grow. On our victuals and our drink. They're a waste of time, these workhouse boys. Always cost more to keep them what they're worth. But still, you men always think you know best.
But there's an expression of melancholy on his face, which is very interesting. He would make a delightful coffin follower. Not a coffin follower for the grown-ups, but only for the children's practice. It would be very novel to have a follower in proportion, my sweet.
Yes, it's a possibility. Well then, boy, what's your name?
Oliver, or the Twist Man.
Singular name.
Yes, ma'am. One of my children.
Oh, yours, Mr. Bumble.
Yes, ma'am. We name our fondlings in alphabetical order. The last one was an S. Sobble, I named him. This one is a T. Twist, I named him.
Morphin then, Mr. Bumble?
Yes, ma'am. The boy's mother came to us destitute. Brought the child into the world. Takes one look at the boy. And promptly dies without leaving so much as a forwarding name and address.
Well then, Oliver Twist, do you think you can look like that gentleman up here?
Maybe. Perhaps. If I had a tall hat.
Never mind, tall.
The boy's quite right. These things must be done proper and correct. Get the boy a tall hat. Stand under the portrait here, boy.
Where'd you hide my hat?
Right there.
I knew that. Delightful.
Very becoming.
Yes, for once, Henry, maybe you had a decent idea. Well then, boy, do you think you can keep that expression for a long time with the crowd watching you?
Yes, ma'am. I think so.
He's a born undertaker's new. I can see him in a black silk suit, following behind the funeral procession with his features fixed in the suitable expression. There'll be horses with tall black plumes to escort us to the family tombs, with mourners in our corners who've been taught to weep in turn. Then that coffin lined with satin, that's your funeral.
That's your funeral.
Large enough to wear your hat in, that's your funeral.
That's your funeral.
We're just here to glamorize you for that endless sleep. You might just as well look fetching when you're 6 feet deep. At the wake, we'll drink our toddy to the body beautiful. That's your funeral. If you're fond of overeating, that's your funeral.
That's your funeral.
Starve yourself by undereating, that's your funeral.
That's your funeral. Visualize the earth descending on you, clod by clod. You can come back when you're buried underneath the sun.
We will not be reduce our prices, keep your voices, use your word. That's your funeral.
Not a funeral.
That's your funeral.
I don't think this song is funny.
That's your funeral.
That's your funeral.
Here's the boy, now where's the money?
That's your funeral.
That's your funeral.
We don't have a fox in the car, but there's no need to frown. In the end, we'll either burn you up or nail you down. We love hops and pieces and diseases called incurable. That's your funeral.
No, that's funeral.
That's your.
Junior coffin follower. Have you eaten yet?
No, ma'am. Not
Charlotte?
Charlotte!
What?
Bring in them cold bits we put out for the dog. It hasn't been in all day, so I can go without them. Charlotte?
What?
This is the new boy. Give them to him.
That's all there is.
Don't just stand there. Put down the blinds. Henry, go to bed.
A superb idea, the more I think about it. A follower in proportion.
Have you done?
Yes, ma'am.
Good. The dogs can have it next. The bed's under the counter here. You don't mind sleeping among coffins, I suppose. Well, it doesn't really matter whether you do or you don't. You can't sleep nowhere else.
Thank you.
sir.
How old are you?
11, sir.
Then I'll rock you one when I get in. You just see it, but a little workhouse brat.
Did you knock, sir?
I did.
Did you want a coffin, sir?
No, but you'll be one soon if you start cheating your superiors. I don't suppose you happen to know who I am, workhouse?
No, sir. I can't say as I do.
Well, I'm Mr. Noah Claypool, and you're under me. So open up the blind, you idle young scallywag.
I saved a nice little bit of bacon for you, mass breakfast.
Oliver, go take them bits of them in the corner. And look at those. I want you to mind the shop where they're gone. Do you hear?
Do you hear, workhouse?
Here's your bacon, Noah.
Nice and greasy. Just how I like it. What you stand at, workhouse?
Oh, no, I let the boy alone.
Let him alone? I'm giving the boy a change, you silly thing. Everyone's left him alone. His mother left him alone. His father left him alone. They all left him alone.
Except good old, kind old Noah.
I better go downstairs. Something's funny.
Workhouse, how's your mother?
I beat my mother out of it. She's dead.
Would she die of workhouse? Shortage of breath?
She's just dead. She died of a broken heart.
Well, turn around and roll right following, workhouse. What set you sniveling now?
You better not say anything more, see?
Better not say anything more, see?
Da, cheek of it. Workhouse, cheek of it. You know, workhouse, can't help it now. Of course you couldn't help it back then. I'm very sorry for it. Sure we all are.
And pity you very much. But you must know, workhouse, your mother was a regular, right down baddie.
What did you say?
It's a good thing she died when she did. She would have been transported to Australia. Hung from a gibbet. Like this one. Ah! Help! Help! Charlotte! It's out of the room! There's no one to mess with me! Charlotte!
Young savage!
Isn't there?
Oliver!
You let me out of here!
Do you know this here voice, Oliver?
Yes, I do!
And ain't you afraid of it, Oliver? Ain't you a-trembling while you hear me speak, Oliver?
No, I'm not!
The boy must be mad. No one in half the senses would venture to speak to you like that.
It's not madness, ma'am. It's meat.
What?
Meat, ma'am, meat. You've overfed him, ma'am. You've grown an artificial spirit and soul into the boy, unbecoming of his station in life.
But this is what becomes of being overgenerous.
If you kept him on cool, ma'am, none of this would have ever happened.
What? Henry, the new boy, Oliver, you have no idea what he's been up to. We had to lock him up.
Help!
Who's in there? Get up! Get up! Get off the coffin. Ow. Get out of there! Oh, that coffin was not supposed to be occupied until tomorrow. It's reserved for a very important client.
You've been drinking.
No.
What's your explanation for this, you young scallywag?
He called my mother name.
Well, what if he did, you ungrateful wretch? She probably deserved what was said, and worse.
She didn't.
Yes, she did.
It's a lie.
Food, hot sausage and mustard. Oh, wow, we're in the mood. Cold jelly and custard.
Change. That's if any other gentleman he knows introduces you. And does he know me? I should say he does. Not if he don't answer.
Who is this respectful old gentleman? Is he a charity gentleman?
Well, I wouldn't say that exactly. Not exactly. But if I introduce you, it's okay on account of I happen to have a particular favor of Mr. Fagin's. That's his name, Mr. Fagin. By the way, if I'm introducing you to Fagin, I'd better know your name, you old China.
My name's Oliver. Oliver Twist.
And I'm Jack Dawkins. Better known amongst your more intimate friends as the Artful Dodger.
Pleased to meet you, Mr. Dawkins.
You too. Come to think of it, I'm gonna be intimate friends. Well, either way, you're coming with me.
Are you sure Mr. Fagin won't mind?
Mind?
Come on,
to get along constantly yourself. Oh well then, constantly yourself. Put the rock on the chair. There is the lot. Tis there. Don't guess what every dog is saying. Then the drinks are all the ass. Consider yourself our mate. We don't want to have no boss. For hours of consideration we can't say. Consider yourself one of us. Consider yourself
at home.
Consider yourself
one of the family.
Thank you.
I brought someone here to see you. His name is Oliver Twist. He's an interesting fella. I found him in London. He was just sitting right near the monument. Come on down.
Sir.
I hope I shall have the honor of your most intimate acquaintance. We're very glad to see you, Oliver. Very. Aren't we, my dear?
Yeah. Mr. Twist has come to London to seek his fortune.
Ah? So you've come to London to seek your fortune, have you? We must see what we can do to help you. Are you hungry?
Starving.
Would you like a sausage? Charlie, take off the sausages. Georgia, draw a chair up near the fire for Oliver.
Fagin, these sausages, they're moldy.
Ah, shut up and drink your gin. Ah, I see you're staring at the pocket handkerchiefs, are you? Quite a lot of them, aren't there? We've just hung them up for the washes, all Oliver, that's all.
Is this a laundry then, sir?
Well, I suppose a laundry would be a very nice thing indeed, but our line of work pays a little bit better, don't it, boy?
Uh-huh, yeah.
You see, Oliver, in this life, one thing counts. In the banks, large amounts. I'm afraid these don't grow on trees. You've got to pick a pocket or two. Got to pick a pocket or two, boys. You've got to pick a pocket or two.
Large amounts don't grow on trees. You've got to pick a pocket or two.
That's all about it. Stupidly paying tax. Better get some untaxed income. Better pick a pocket or two. You gotta pick a pocket or two. Boys, you've got to pick a pocket or two.
Why should we all break our backs? You better pick a pocket or two.
Who says crime doesn't pay?
Yeah.
Robin Hood, what a crook, gave away what he took. Charity's fine, subscribe to mine. Get out and pick a pocket or two. You got to pick a pocket or two. Boys, you've got to pick a pocket or two.
Robin Hood was far too good. He had to pick a pocket or two.
My merry men. Take a tip from Bill Sykes. He can whip what he likes. I recall he started small. He had to pick a pocket or two. You gotta pick a pocket or two, boys. Oh, you gotta pick a pocket or two.
We can be like the Bill Sykes.
Dear old gent, passing by, something nice takes his eye. Everything's clear, attack the rear. Get in and pick a pocket or two. Gotta pick a pocket or two, boys. What? They were brown when I got them. Ah, you've got to pick a pocket or two.
Hand the beer out.
Someone rich, both my thumbs start to itch, only to find some peace of mind. I have to pick a pocket or two. You've got to pick a pocket or two, boys. Oh, enough of you. You've got to pick a pocket or two.
Said all of them? Never? Come here. Show me your hand. Yes, yes. Show me the other one. Okay, show me the other one again. All right. Both at the same time. Get out of here. What a crook. I hope you've been hard at work today, my dear.
Hard?
What have you got for me, daughter?
Couple wallets.
Ah, well lined, I hope.
And the best.
Not as heavy as they might be, but still very nicely made. An ingenious workman, ain't you, Oliver?
Did he make these himself?
With his own lily white hands.
Oh, you be quiet, Charlie. And what have you got for me?
Nose rags.
Well, they're very good. Though you haven't embroidered the initials too well. H-R-H.
Cool!
So they'll have to be picked out of the needle. Yes, he'll have to learn how to do that too, won't he, boys?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And you'll have to learn how to make wallets like the Dodger here. You'd like that, wouldn't you?
Yes, Mr. Fagin, if you'll teach me.
Certainly, my boy. Just do everything you see Dodger and Charlie here do. Make them your role models. Especially Dodger here. He's going to be a right little Bill Sykes.
Who's Bill Sykes, Mr. Fagin?
All in good time, Oliver. All in good time. Now then, can you see my silk handkerchief? What is protruding from my pocket?
Yes, Mr. Fagin.
See if you can take it without my noticing. Like you saw the other boys do. Rum-tum-tum, tum-tum-tum, pom-pom-pom, pom-pom-pom. Skittle-tie-righty-tie-tie-righty-rap-a-pa-pa-pa-pa-tum-tum. You've got a bigger pocket or two, boys. You've got a bigger pocket or two. Is it gone?
Yes, Mr. Fagin, it's in my hand.
Why, clever boy! I never saw a sharper lad. Here's a shilling for you. All right. I gotta go to the bank first. No! All right, now bedtime, all of you.
No!
I'll start singing again.
Where shall I sleep, sir?
Here by the warm, Oliver. I'll get you a nightcap.
Yes, please.
Hi. Pour out a cocoa. Have a drop of gin instead.
Crap!
All right, settle down, would you? Dodger, take your hat off in bed. Where's your manners? Yes, you're quite the gentleman now, Oliver. You've got a home or a profession? And a shilling on credit. If you go on this way, you'll be the greatest man of all times. Good night, Oliver, my dear. Bill? At this hour? A bit late, isn't it? I mean, people are trying to sleep around here. I don't know. Where's the consideration? Where's the common decency? I'll have to give him a piece of my mind, I will.
Oh!
Bill! So good to see you. Can I help you? Oh, Bill, that is lovely. Shame there's only the one of them, though, because if you had a matching pair...
bet you knew that, Bill. You're a professional. Always have been. Oh, that is a lovely teapot. Seems everyone's drinking coffee nowadays, but I'm sure there's a bob in it once I put a hallmark on it. Whoa, blimey, Bill. How did you do it? What else have you got in there? A grand piano? Ugly, isn't it? That the lot, then? Oh, be hurrying? For me? Why, you shouldn't have. I mean, this is all so sudden. I ought to have shaved. I'm only joking, of course. Costume jewelry at the best, but I'm sure we could pass it off as something a little bit better. Well, good night, Bill.
Hey.
What, Bill? Me? Keep cash around you with all these thieves about? Oh, I wouldn't dare.
Pagan.
Look, I have to price it first, right and proper. I'll have the money to you by tomorrow. We'll meet at the usual place. Free cripples. That's a promise, Bill.
It better be.
Why, hello there, my pretties. Hello,
Mr. Finding.
How are you doing today?
We're doing just fine. Thank you for asking.
I've brought a new friend to see you. His name is Mr. Ruby. Oh, hello there. My name is Mr. Ruby.
Hello. My name is Mrs. Diamond.
It's a pleasure to meet you, Mrs. Diamond. Do you have any more friends I can meet?
Oh, in fact, I do. I have Mrs. Pearl and her twin sisters. Why, hello there.
Hello there.
Hello there.
Hi, hello there, Mrs. Pearl. How are you?
I'm doing quite well. Yeah, me too. Don't forget about me.
It's good to meet all of you. Yes, but there's one more person you absolutely must meet before you can join them. Who more dare be, Mr. Fagin? Why? Only the lovely Miss Tiara! I do love shiny things. Ah! Oh, how long were you awake? What did you see? Quick, speak! I want to know every detail.
I'm sorry, sir. I couldn't sleep.
Were you awake half an hour ago?
No.
15 minutes?
Not that I know of.
Be sure, boy. Be sure.
I'm sure.
Well, then, if you're sure, I'm sure. You're a very brave boy, Oliver. I was only trying to scare you. Boo. Did you see any of those pretty things, Oliver?
Yes, sir.
Well, they're mine. My private property. It's all I have to live on in my old age. Terrible thing, Oliver. Old age.
Do you think I could get up now?
Certainly, my boy. There's a wash basin waiting for you right there.
But I had a wash yesterday.
Well, today's your birthday.
Wash.
Nancy!
Wake up, boys!
The ladies are here.
We'll have less of that if you don't mind. So where's the gin then, Fagin?
All in moderation, Nancy. All in moderation. Too much gin can be a terrible thing for a pure young creature like you.
And what's wrong with a bit of danger then, eh, Mr. Fate? After all, it's the only bit of excitement we'll get. And you will deny us these small pleasures. Small pleasures, small pleasures. Who would deny us these?
Not me.
Gin and toddies, large measures. No skipping if you please. I rock it, I love it. Life is a game of chance. I never tire of it. Lead to Mary, darling.
that.
Oh, Nancy,
oh my
no.
gosh.
If you don't mind having a go without things, it's a fine life, it's a fine life. Though it ain't all joy or pleasure at ease, it's a fine life,
it's a fine life.
When you got someone to love, you forget your cares and strives. The broods of downers at the wide world frownless, it's a fine, fine life.
Ain't that right, Ben?
Yeah, that's right, Nancy. Cares it straight, lace it snare. In the street, fine as in fine graces, don't have to sit to eat. We wander through London, and those that we may find. There's pockets left unlocked, so many are behind. If you don't mind taking it like a turd out, it's a fine life,
it's a fine life.
Keep the candle. Come by the occasional black eye. You can always cover one till he blacks the other one, but you don't dare cry. No flounces, no feathers, no fools of bad rollouts. All winds and all weathers ain't good for fancy clothes. These crumbs, these tatters, these we can go so for.
Absolutely.
Go on, Nancy. Give us a free show.
So, how's it going, Dodger? It's all about an absolute fender.
Don't let your petticoat dangle in the mud, my darling.
And I'll go last.
No, I'll go last. I'd do anything for you, dear. Anything for you. Mean everything to me. I know that I'd go anywhere for your smile. Anywhere for your smile. Everywhere I'll see.
And would you climb a hill?
Anything.
Wear a daffodil?
Anything.
Leave me on your will?
Anything.
Even fight my bill?
What fisticuffs? I risk everything for one kiss. Anything, yes, I do anything,
anything,
anything for you.
Go on then, Nancy, give Oliver a go.
You know, Oliver,
So long, farewell, pit picture, you will be Hey, give that back. Come on, give it back. Wait, stop that boy! My pocket's been
city.
cause enough to fear it. It's much blacker than they smear it. Nobody mentions my name. Rich men hold their £5 notes out. Saves me emptying their coats out. They know I could tear their throats out just to live up to my name. With me, Jimmy and me, and let me see the man who dares stop me taking what I may. He can start to say his prayers. Biceps like an iron gutter, fit for doing of a murder. If I just so much as heard a bloke even whisper my name, Bill Sykes, some tough slumming with his valet, bumped in to me in the alley. Now his eyes will never tally. He never heard of my name. One bloke used to boast a claim he could take my name in vain. Poor bloke, shame he was so green, never was he seen again. What's bad? What's the good in turning? Inhale, I'll be there a-burning. Meanwhile, think of what I'm earning, all on account of my name. What is it?
Supposed to never let him out of our sight!
Who?
One of us, Bill, a new boy. Went on his first job today with Dodger. I'm afraid he might say something that will get us into trouble.
That's very likely. You'll blow the pond, Fanny.
And you see, my dear, if the game were up with us, it might be up with many other. And I'm afraid things would come out rather worse for you than they would for me, my dear.
What you owe? Someone has to find out what's been done or said. If he hasn't talked yet, there's still a chance we might get him back here without suspicion. We'll nab him the very moment he dares to step out of that house. Now who's gonna go?
I guess it'll have to be me.
You shut your trap, Dodger! You've caused enough harm already. Yes, it's got to be done quiet. We don't want any fuss. Ah, the very thing. Nancy, my dear, you're so very good with the boy. Why don't you go?
It's no good trying to go with me.
And just what you mean by that remark?
What did I say, Bill? I'm not going. Why can't you leave the boy alone? He won't do me no harm. Why can't you leave him where he is? We'll get a chance at a decent life.
You'll get him and bring him back here, my girl. Unless you want to feel my hands on your throat.
Nancy, Nancy. Think of what would happen to Bill if he were to say something. It would be the gallows for him, Nancy. The gallows! You wouldn't let that happen to Bill, would you? Not your Bill.
She'll go, Fagin.
No, she won't, Fagin.
Yes, she will. Thank you. Get out! Go!
As long as he needs me, oh yes, he does need me, in spite of what you see, I'm sure that he needs me, who else would love him? When they've been used so ill, he knows I always will. As long as he needs me, I miss him so much when he's gone. But when he's near me, I don't. Inside the love I have to hide, the hell I've got, my pride. As long as he needs me, he doesn't say the things he should, he acts the way he thinks he should. All the same of love.
Thank you.
someone who will
Grimwig, I think you'll find a great improvement in the boy.
That, sir, is for me to decide.
So, Oliver, how are you feeling today, my boy?
Very happy, sir. May I stay here always?
If you wish, my boy, then you shall. Here's Dr. Grimwig, came to see you.
Well, he seems to be looking better, but you're still not sleeping well, aren't you?
No, sir, I sleep very well.
Ah, but bad dreams, I've no doubt. Nightmares, eh?
No, Doctor, I don't have dreams.
Thought so. But you're hungry, aren't you?
No, Doctor.
No? You're not hungry. Not thirsty, are you? If that boy is not thirsty, I'll eat my head. Are you?
Yes, sir, I am rather thirsty.
Just as I expected. It's very natural he should be thirsty. You may give him a little tea.
Thank you, Doctor.
May I get up now?
Say, I think you may, and take a little fresh air. Be sure not to keep him too warm, Mrs. Bedwood, but make sure that he doesn't get too cold. You have the goodness.
Certainly, Doctor.
You'll be glad to be up again, Oliver. This way, Doctor.
Do I wear this?
Well, you can't wear your old clothes. They've gone to the furnace. Hurry now.
He's a fine-looking boy, don't you think, Grimwig?
Couldn't tell you. I only know two sorts of boys. Mealy boys and beef-faced boys.
And which is Oliver?
Mealy. Where does he come from?
You know, I haven't the faintest idea. He was arrested for stealing my pocket handkerchief. When the shopkeeper found out what really happened, I brought him here to make what amends I could. But I must confess, I find myself strangely attached to the child.
He's deceiving you, my good friend. He has a fever. What of that? Fevers are not peculiar to good people, are they? Bad people get fevers sometimes, don't they? He stole your pocket handkerchief. He'll steal more, sir. And what do you know of him? Nothing.
Only that he's an orphan, and yet, it's strange. There's something about that boy's face. I can't explain it, but I feel like I've seen him somewhere before. A very long time ago.
Stuff and nonsense. You're imagining things.
Yes, what is it?
There's someone here to see you, sir.
What does he want?
Books from the bookseller, sir.
Ah, thank you very much. Now I've got to give you these in return to... Oh, wait! I particularly wished for these books to be returned today.
Why not send Oliver with them?
Yes, please let me take the books for you, please, sir.
Well, all right. If you wish, you shall. Let me tell you what to do. You take these books to Mr. Jessup, tell him you've come to pay the full £10 that I owe him. Here's £5. There's no need to rush, but I shall expect you back in 10 minutes. It's just down the road.
She's a very pretty lady, isn't she, sir?
Yes, it's a portrait of my daughter, Agnes.
I'll take the books, then.
Yes, you take the books. Off you go.
You don't really expect him to come back, do you? With a new suit of clothes on his back and a £5 note in his pocket. If that boy comes back, I'll eat my head.
Dr. Grimwig, take a look at this portrait. Don't you see an extraordinary resemblance between Oliver and my daughter, Agnes?
Can't say that I do.
Well, then, in 10 minutes when the boy returns, I think you will.
Yes, Mr. Brownlow. 10 minutes.
It could not have been twice. Where is the man with the
away 2 weeks ago from his parents, who are hard-working, respectable people. Why did you understand these bad characters he did? Almost broke his mother's heart.
The young rat? Go home, you little brute!
I'm not! I haven't any mother or father! I'm an old witch!
Just listen to him!
But tell them to let me go!
See? He knows his sister. He can't hide that. He can come home or it'll be the death of us!
What the devil's all this?
I was just playing it up.
Young Oliver, come on home to your poor mother.
You young dog. Come on home. What's this? Books too? You've been stealing it, have you? He's nothing but a thief and a vagabond.
Oh, leave him alone.
That's right. That's what he needs.
Let go! I don't belong to them! Help! Help!
You're coming with us, you little bleeder.
Leave him alone, though.
Say goodbye to your fancy living.
So you've come home again, have you, Oliver, my dear?
Look at his dogs, Dragon!
He's got books, too! What a little gent, ain't he?
Delighted to see you looking so well, Oliver. The artful tortoise will give you a new suit for fear that you might spoil that lovely Sunday one. But why didn't you write and tell us you were coming? We would have had something warm for supper.
Cor! Look at this!
Hey, what's that? That's mine, Fagin.
No, no, Bill. Mine! You can have the book!
Shut up! If that ain't mine, mine Nancy's, that is, I'll take the boy back again. Now, come on, hand over.
This is hardly fair, Bill. Hardly! Is it, Nancy?
Fair or not fair, hand it over, you avaricious old skeleton. Give it here. That's why I share the trouble, and not half enough neither. Here, you can have the books. Start a library.
No. You can't keep the books for money. They belong to Mr. Brownell, and if he finds out you've got them, he'll be down here after all of you.
So he'll be down here, really?
Leave him alone, though.
What'd you tell him about us?
Nothing.
That remains to be seen. But if we find out you said anything, anything out of place, Fagin, I'll wager the young scoundrels told him everything. Hey! Hey!
Help! Help!
Oh, hit me, would you?
Leave him alone.
Stand off me or I'll split your head open.
Go on then! Kill me! You have to before I let you lay a hand on that boy.
Stay out of this, I'm warning you!
All right, enough already! We've got him back! What's the matter with you?
The girl's gone mad, I think, Fagin.
If she hasn't, Fagin, don't think it.
Then keep quiet, will you? All this violence.
Tell him all about us, won't you?
I won't stand by and see it done, Bill.
Why, Nancy, you're wonderful tonight. Such talent. What an actress.
Am I? Take care I don't overdo it. Because if I do, I'm going to put my mark on some of you, and I don't care if I ain't for it.
You? Do you know who you are and what you are?
Oh, yeah, I know all about that. You don't have to tell me.
A fine one for the boy to make a friend of you are.
Lord, help me, I am, and I wish I'd been struck down dead before I let a hand and bring him back here. Except after tonight, he's a liar and a thief, and all that's bad isn't enough for you without beating him to death.
Come, come, Nancy. We must have civil words. Civil words, Bill.
Civil words? You deserve it from me, don't you? Because I was out on the streets for you, and I was a child half his age. And I've been on the same train and same service. 15 years, don't you forget it!
Well, what have you had? It's your living, ain't it?
Something, something!
What you deserve, you get!
No getting or giving!
Must live murders yet.
There'll be murder.
because there'll be terror such as you've never seen.
No violence.
Watching Nancy
Minor's ever staring in between.
No violence.
Light.
If you don't know I'm making them make a second, it's a fine line.
Fine line.
My life's taken.
No, we don't mind keeping the angels waiting. It's a fine line.
Fine line.
Fine line.
Better do as you are told.
Watch out.
Bill has got a heart of gold.
Get out on the job. Shut your gob.
The best of it's a fine. Take care of him, Dodger, and I'll take care of myself. They paint. I'm reviewing the situation. Can the fellow be a villain all his life? All the trials and tribulations. Better settle down and get myself a wife. And the wife could cook and sew for me and come for me and go for me and go for me and nag at me. The fingers she would wag at me, the money she would take from me, the misery she'd make from me. I think I better think it out again. From now. So how to win friends and to influence people? So how? I'm reviewing the situation. I must quickly look up everyone I know. Entitled people with a station who can help me make a real impressive show. I would own the suite at Claridge's and run the fleet of carriages and wave at all the duchesses with friendliness as much as is befitting of my new estate. Good morrow to you, magistrate. I think I better think it out again. Dearest companions have always been villains and thieves. So at my time of life, I should start turning over new leaves. I'm reviewing the situation. If you want to eat, you've got to earn a bob. Is it such a humiliation for a robber to perform an honest job? So a job I'm getting possibly. I wonder who my boss will be. I wonder if he'll take to me. What bonuses he'll make to me. I'll start at night and finish late. All right. Wait. I think I'd better think it out again. What happens when I'm 17? Must come a time 17. When you're old and it's cold, and who cares if you live or you die? One consolation's the money you may have put by. I'm the situation. I'm abandoned and abandoned I shall stay. You'll be seeing no transformation. Well, it's wrong to be a rogue in every way. I don't want nobody hurt from me or made to do the dirt for me. The spot in life is not for me. It's getting far too hard for me. There is no in between for me, but who would change a scene for me? Don't want no one to rob for me, but who will find a job for me? I think I better think it out again.
Tomorrow. It was done. It seems an age. I sold myself for 6 teaspoons, a pair of sugar tongs, a milk pot with a small quantity of second-hand furniture, and £20 cash. I went very reasonable. Cheap. Dirt cheap.
Oh, cheap? Oh, Mr. Bumble, you would have been damned any price. And dear's the price I paid for you. Lord above knows that. Are you going to sit there and snore all day?
I will sit here as long as I like. And although I was not snoring, I will snore, gape, sneeze, laugh, or cry as my humor strikes me, such being my prerogative.
Your prerogative?
That's the word, madam. The prerogative of a man is to command.
So, what's the prerogative of a woman in the name of goodness?
To obey, madam. To obey. Your late unfortunate husband should have taught you that. And then maybe he'd still be here today if he did. And I wish he was. Poor man.
Oh, you're hard-hearted.
Cry away, madam. It opens the lungs, clears the eyes, calms the temper, and washes the face. So cry away, madam!
Now talk to me about your prerogative, if you dare.
I
don't talk! Shut up! Get yourself out of here, out of my house, before I do something desperate! Are you going?
Certainly, my dear. Certainly. I had no intention of staying. You're just being so very violent!
It's old Sally, ma'am. She says she's got something to tell you, but that must be hurting. She's not got long, and she's not gonna die quiet till you listen.
Turn him away.
But that was your friend.
You heard the lady. Get out of my house!
Well,
now listen to me. Listen to me. Listen. In this very workhouse, I once nursed a pretty young creature who came in from the cold with her feet cut and bruised with walking. She gave birth to a boy and died. Let me think. What was the year again?
Oh, never mind the year, what of it?
I brought her. I brought her, so I did. The only thing she had of any worth, it was round her neck, and it was gold.
Gold? Well, do tell.
This is it, the locket. She charged me to keep it safe and trusted me. It's my belief she came from a rich family.
The boy's name?
They called him...
Yes!
Oliver! The gold I stole was...
Oopsie daisy. We must retrieve that boy, Mr. Bumble!
We must indeed, madam! We must indeed! Oliver! Oliver! If the truth were known, we both were delighted at seeing the back of him. Oliver, Oliver, what will we do?
We must give him his due. And we'll praise the day somebody gave us.
Raise the flag.
Coming to save us.
Cash rewards, floods of promotion.
Who'd have thought?
And a notion. Praise the Lord.
Did you bring that here?
I hear you bring information regarding the boy, Oliver Twist.
Yes. We decided to come and answer to your advertisement.
I decided.
Oh, yes, that's right. My... dear wife decided. Bumble is my name, sir. Beadle of the workhouse was a boy was cared for. From where he was apprenticed by an undertaker. From where he ran away.
Yes,
from...
yes, it's very good of you to come. Now, what have you got to tell me?
This locket was given by the lad's dying mother to my dear wife just before she passed away.
Beg your pardon?
The lad's dying mother, that is! Not my wife!
Okay, so you're saying when he left your workhouse, he went to an undertaker's?
Yes, Mr. Salisbury. The undertaker bought Oliver from us for £3.
Wait, so you mean to say that you sold him like an animal?
Well, it was Mrs. Bumble who actually authorized the sale.
Oh, really? Then I shall see that neither of you is employed in a position of trust again. And your behavior, madam, was shameful. Leave my house.
How dare you speak to me that way? I can't... We came here to help you!
You came here in hope of profiting from your own greed and dishonesty!
As to that, sir... the trinket don't properly belong to my dear wife.
Oh, would you shut up, you fat old fool!
Here, £10. Take it, and consider yourselves fortunate that you don't find yourselves in the hands of the law. Mrs. Bedwinter. Show these ghastly people out.
We know our own way out. Thank you! I'll take that with me.
I hope, sir, that this little... unfortunate little circumstance will not deprive me of my parochial office.
Oh, indeed it will, and you may think of yourself well off besides.
But it was Mrs. Bumble! She would do it!
That's no excuse. You were present in the occasion of when the boy was sold, and indeed more guilty of the two in the eye of the law. For the law supposes that your wife acts under your direction.
If the law supposes that, then the law's ridiculous! If that's the eye of the law, then the law's a bachelor! Then the worst that I wish the law is, that it's I may
be opened by experience! Experience!
Mrs. Bedwins, take a look at this miniature. Can you see who's on it?
Why, it's Miss Agnes, sir.
Yes, my daughter, Agnes. She must have found her way into the workhouse and had a child there.
If only she'd told us.
Mrs. Bedwin, who is this?
It's about the boy, sir.
Have you news of Oliver?
He's in danger. In bad company. He was dragged off the day you sent him out with the books.
Who took him? Where can I find him?
Me and someone else.
Who's this other person you speak of? Please, take me
to... No, I shouldn't have said that.
Oh, come on. Sit down. You want to help the boy, don't you? Why else are you here?
I do, but...
Then at least just tell me where I can find him.
I can't. But I'll bring him to you. Not here. It's too far.
Where, then?
The bridge. London Bridge. Tonight, at midnight. And you've got to come alone. Promise me you'll come on your own, and I'll find a way of getting him to you. You don't believe me, do you? But if you want Oliver back, then you've got to believe me.
Very well, then. I'll be there.
Thank God.
Wait, has the boy been hurt? Ill-treated?
No.
If so, I shall...
I can't say no more, please. You'll kill me as it is if he finds out where I've been.
Who's this other person you speak of? Perhaps we can come to an arrangement.
No. We can't. Whatever else I do, I won't turn on him.
I understand, my dear.
But a man who might kill you?
Yeah. But he's mine. And I'm his. And I've got to go back. And I want to go back.
Sir.
you stay here and I look for Mr. Bramble. He's a good boy.
take you home now.
Maybe it's strange, but it's possible. Oh, my bosom companions and treasures, I've left them behind. I'll turn the leaf over, and who knows just what I may find.
Thank you.
we'd like to thank some people, starting with our backstage crew. Can we get you out here? Special shout out to our stage manager, Jake.
So we would not have been able to do this if we didn't have a set. It would have been pretty boring. So we would like to thank all the dads who did such a great job on our sets. Mr. Hecker, I don't know if you're here, but he basically built a lot of the stuff single-handedly. He's a beast. Mr. Carl, Mr. Kafka, my dad, Mr. Humanaic. I'm probably missing somebody. You can come kick me afterward. I don't care. But thank you, thank you, thank you.
We'd also like to thank all the moms who, I mean, they made half of these costumes. They're pretty cool. Mrs. Humanaic, Mrs. Williams, Mrs. McLean, my mom, and Mrs. Howell, especially, for coordinating all of this. Pretty great.
We'd also like to thank Mr. Dave from this school. He's helped out with so much, spending so many hours during Tech Week, putting up that backdrop. Mr. Dave, are you here?
Is there a Dave?
Dave!
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 Dave! He's here.
Coming down the lane.
He's coming down.
He's
somewhere.
Yeah!
All right, well, there
he is.
I'd like to thank you again for all the hours that you put into it. You really helped make this possible. Thank you.
Thank you. That's great to work.
One more time, guys.
Next, we would like to thank, well, in theater, most people are very creative, but you can't get anywhere if you don't have a business side of things. So you need someone who's, like, organized. So we would like to thank Mrs. Dougherty. And we would not have been able to do it without you.
Very dedicated and very loyal and very loving. So
God has definitely sent you. You're definitely sent from God. We really appreciate you and we love you. Thank you.
This evening wouldn't be done without a little more humiliation, so... Lauren! Choreographing everything, making us look amazing while we're singing and moving around. And she also deals with my sweat a lot when putting on makeup for hours on end. And
which is pretty nasty.
Yeah. And it's also very much a blessing to get to work with you. And you really shine through with your work and all the dedication you put into this. Thank you so much.
That's it, we'll see you in the lobby.